Happy week to you, folks. It is Matt Powell with Pramek Radio. Wherever you are in the world, whatever time of day it is, I hope you're having a great day like I am right now. It's been a great week for Pramek. It's always a great week. Last week we had I just had to take back control of the mic with no guest for the week and actually answer those questions. So I hope you enjoyed listening to me. So many people had said, Matt, are you going to take back the mic every now and then, do a little solo? So had to do the solo and make sure that we answered those questions that were out there. This week we have an incredible guest. It's Dr. Brad Johns. He's a friend of mine, well-known, nationally known. I want to say world known after this. He's definitely internationally known after this Pramek Radio episode. Psychiatrist. He's also a second degree black belt in Bondo. And he's also a student of Pramek and Sage Dynamics. I've been on the line many a times with Dr. Johns, and he's a great source of information for so many things related to training through his years of training and his exposure to so many different topics. And we're going to get into a lot of great information that you're going to be able to use to be able to become a better martial artist. But first, we have a little bit of a congratulations. Shine your light like an atom bomb blast. Cannonballs clash, head on crash. Smash into ashes, break apart. Use the heart, make the most of who you are. Run against the wind like a barbarian. Under the skin is the beast within. Yeah, that's E-Sick. You know, the Wolf Fitness family up in Salinas, California, the Pramek extended family, we just keep growing. And I want to go ahead and congratulate Eric E-Sick Mellon now. He is our Pramek fitness guru, our main fitness instructor and teacher and coach, everything that you can imagine that is fitness related. So many people have bought his Warrior Mode videos, and he has actually accepted a position with Onnit and Onnit Academy to be a head coach. So he's making that long drive down to Austin, Texas, to go ahead and take his place with the greats down there. He's going to be down there with John Wolf, he's been on the show in the past, and he's going to be coming up in the near future. And E-Sick is actually going to be our guest next week. We're going to be talking about Warrior Mode and fitness and stability, how he's developed the programs that he's developed, what's next for him with Onnit. So make sure next week that you tune in and you listen to Eric E-Sick Mellon, and we're going to be talking about some great things with Pramek Fitness and Onnit Academy. Now, I'm a big fan of free stuff, so we're going to go ahead and give you some free stuff. You go over to Pramek.com/shop. That's Pramek.com/shop. In the shop, you can pick up any of our items. We're going to do a coupon code for this week. And it's Pramek Radio. That's Pramekradio. No space. So if you start using a space and it doesn't work, don't email me and be mad that you can't get your 20% off. It's 20% off everything in the shop. So you can pick up the new E6 new Warrior Mode Basic Training. It's an hour-long video. It's going to smoke you. It's a great video. Or you can pick up the Pramek Fitness Set, which has everything. It has all the E6 videos. It has the F3 Fitness video that Aaron and Cowan and I did together. Or you can also pick up Defense Around Vehicles, which is our newest video and is making a lot of waves in the combatives community. So make sure you go over to Pramek.com/shop. There's something for everybody between our awesome interactive manuals, which are PDF. You can put them on your iPhone and watch the video and read them. Or you can read the CLM. You can look at our combatives videos or our fitness videos. And that's Pramek Radio. That's the coupon. 20% off over at Pramek.com/shop. Or if you just go to Pramek.com, look up at the very top, and you will see shop. Go ahead and click it and use that coupon code until October 1st. And I am here with Dr. Brad Johns. Dr. Brad, how are you?
I'm good.
We are here at the Pramek Radio Studios, which means we're in the spare room of my house. You are looking at some of the weapons up on the wall. And you had the, you were looking at the kukri. Now you've got a little bit of experience with the kukri, right?
I do. It's the short sword of the American Bondo Association that we train with, and I've got an upcoming clinic with Dr. Mong Ji here in about a month. I'm trying to prepare for. We're going to be a lot of focus on the kukri as well as other weapons.
So he's still teaching.
He is. This is probably going to be his last big seminar. It's we have the American Bondo Association members coming in from all over the country. It's celebrating 50 years of Bondo in the United States, and I'm just humbled and honored to be a part of it.
How old is he now?
Well, he's in the 80 range. I mean, so.
Wow. And he's still out there. He's still doing
incredible.
It.
He's incredible. His ability to communicate. He was a professor at Ohio University. So his ability to communicate concepts is just spectacular.
Now, what is your training history with Bondo?
Oh, interesting. I started Bondo in Philadelphia back in the 80s, mid 80s, and was working out at a gym. And some of the guys there were black belts and had a school. And they had a kickboxing school. Bondo's many faceted. And so I began training with them. I was in my mid to late 20s and then trained in that type of that aspect of Bondo for a long time. Then came to Atlanta for a year. And then when I went to med school, they had a good teacher there, was a well-established and accomplished Bondo kickboxer, John McNeil. And I trained with him. And that's where I earned my black belt in Cleveland. Then brought it back to Atlanta and trained for a few years. And trained a couple of guys to fight in the kickboxing nationals, and they did very well and won. And then I began having hip problems, so it put me inactive for a long time.
What gave you the hip problems?
Kicking hard objects. We can talk about that later. You know, and it's like, and then I played football. I have a bad knee, so I've had to have a hip and a knee replacement. So, titanium.
You're the bionic man. Now you mentioned,
and it cost about $6 million in 2010.
Now. What is your medical now? You're not only a doctor, but you went to Harvard for theology as well, right?
That's
What's
correct.
What's your background education wise?
Well, I'm an Atlanta native. Went to Lakeside High School here in Atlanta, and then went off to Tulane University, where I double majored in philosophy and religious studies, and was at one point in time pretty on the track to become a professor of philosophy of religion.
I thought you were about to say priest.
No, I never was particularly interested in the calling of the priesthood, but I was very interested in it academically and, concept formation and the philosophy of mind, the philosophy of science, and then pursued a master's in theological studies at Harvard, and it allowed me to take a lot of electives in the general university. And so I became interested in psychology, and I worked as an assistant in a psychiatric hospital, and that's how I kind of made the transition over to psychology, mental health, and psychiatry, and then went off to med school.
Now, what do you do now?
I'm practicing psychiatrist.
The reason I pause when I say that is because I'm looking at your CV over here on my iPad, and it's like 80 pages of medical stuff that I can't read. So that's why I'm looking at it and I'm going, I know what you do, but what do you do?
What's my day like? I trained, did my graduate residency training at Emory University, which was a very esteemed program under the direction of Charlie Nemiroff, who's remained a friend and a mentor to me. And then went into private practice after my residency and had some psychoanalytic training. I didn't complete that. I decided to take a different track. And then I have been working providing inpatient clinical services and outpatient private practice since I finished. And I'm currently a medical director of a psychiatric and chemical dependency hospital. So I do a lot of administrative work and making sure hospital care is delivered on a daily basis to the mentally ill and chemically dependent.
So you would say that you could probably answer some of the questions that we're going to talk about today.
I hope so. I'll do my best.
A lot of times people, they come on and they feel real nervous, like they're not going to be some type of authority. And I'm like, no, that's why I wanted you on, is because you are an authority on what you do. But people do get nervous about it.
Yeah.
So diving right into it, now that people kind of know who you are, and, I had sent over a lot of the questions that we were going to talk about. That way you kind of have an idea. This isn't a blindside, folks. I don't just blindside the guest and they show up. The only blindside is the rapid fire. But I guess the first question, and this is something that I often get when I'm teaching, is how much does our past affect our present when it comes to, our interactions with the world? I always say, you know, it's almost like Vaseline smeared in glasses, that, you know, you've got all these filters of things that have happened to you in the past, and that's kind of how you look at the world in front of you.
Yeah.
Is that kind of accurate, or is it inaccurate, or?
Well, I think it's some of both, really. I mean, our past and how we, you know, we have something in psychiatry we call the biopsychosocial model, which is just kind of a giant umbrella of how we conceptualize the different domains of a human. You know, we have our biology, and our biology develops over time from embryonic to where we are currently. Our psychology develops in a similar way, and our social contacts and our social networks, which would include our parents, our siblings, our schools, our jobs, and so forth, are all kind of in this unbelievably complex matrix, if you will, of our reality. So as we develop the concept of our identity through our childhoods, we tend to transfer that onto the regular world. It's kind of our map of reality, and that can be more or less conscious or unconscious in how we approach novel situations.
How much would you say is there a percentage of conscious to unconscious?
Well, that's a good question. I don't think it's – I would say that our consciousness is probably a pretty small sliver. It makes me think of Freud in his new introductory lectures on psychoanalysis, talking about the depth of the unconscious. And the goal of psychotherapy or psychoanalysis was where id was, their ego shall be. You know, the id is our primitive drives, our survival instincts, our desire to procreate, these types of things. And a lot of that is very primitive and unconscious, to greater or lesser extents, depending on all kinds of factors of how you were brought up and what your current situation is. So I'd say really the conscious is really probably a pretty small part, but I'd hesitate to put percentages on it because it can vary greatly.
But let me rephrase it a little bit. With our interactions with the world, how much would you say is unconscious just auto drive? And how much is us making conscious decisions with the world that we interact in?
Wow. I'd say the psychic determinants are mostly unconscious. That would be my, I guess, gut response. We have what we would call in psychiatry kind of autonomous ego functions, like, you know, checking the locks on the doors or preparing your meals or, you know, taking a shower or speaking to your child about their homework or, you know, communicating to a student.
Now, I know somebody is listening and they're thinking, how is that the ego?
Ah, that's a great question, because ego in a psychoanalytic
Because I got
sense,
a good looking door, but, you know, yeah.
that's a great question.
I make really good burritos.
The word
but
ego in common parlance is often misunderstood. Like, he has a big ego.
Yeah.
Psychodynamically, that's really a good thing, because that's conscious operations of all aspects of our humanity. Whereas ego in common parlance is like, oh, he's got a big ego, meaning kind of narcissistically oriented,
yeah,
or it's kind of a pejorative term. And that's not at all how it's used in like psychiatry and psychoanalysis to talk about the ego. So the more autonomous ego functions you have, that's a healthier individual in a psychoanalytic sense.
So you were talking about those types of things that were unconscious, checking the doors, making the meals, and so forth. And we were talking about, you know, how much of it is conscious interaction with the world and how much of it is unconscious. So you were saying that was automatic ego.
Yeah, I would actually say checking the doors and talking to your kid about homework, those are conscious functions. Our unconscious functions are, say, our more primitive drives. For example, you know, everybody, you know, Freud said it was all sex and aggression. And I don't necessarily think that, and there's been a lot of fleshing out of the theoretical aspects since his time. But those are the drives that allow the human species to continue on, sexuality and aggression, and to protect ourselves. And as my interface in martial arts, maybe we'll talk more about it in a little bit.
That's where I'm going
but
with
those,
all this.
You know, you can't, like, for example, you have to be unconscious or at least balance it. And the ego is balancing the demands of the unconscious and the drives and the id the superego, which is kind of our map of reality, and external reality itself, whatever that is and how we experience it. So the unconscious feelings are more like, you know, you can't beat up anybody given whatever the circumstances are, because there will be consequences, like jail. You can't perpetrate crimes because we have a rule of law. And that can be looked at psychodynamically as healthy ego function that allows civilization to happen.
And no, it makes sense.
So at the unconscious part, it's like you can't, like if someone takes your, you know, Xbox or something, you might have, you know, fantasies of, you know, hurting them because they took your Xbox. But you have to be able to contain that primitive drive to function in society.
No, that makes sense.
You have to keep it unconscious because it's too much, you know. Like if you see a pretty girl, you can't think, well, I'm just going to go over and have my way.
Yeah.
But because you might want to have coffee first. You know, these types of things. So you have to keep those primitive drives more or less unconscious, depending on how you do it. And then, and in pathological development, like in episodes of child abuse, the aggression and all kinds of drives get really confused, and it impairs the healthy development of the ego and conscious function.
Okay. Okay. Yeah. Because what I'm to have a good baseline as we go forward, I want people to be able to kind of look back on this first part and also be able to rewind to it or whatever it is, because it's not like we're talking about, you know, punching somebody with, you know, brass knuckles or something like that. We're going to end up talking about some of these types of terms that, you know, being able to go back and reference a few pages back as we get going. And that's why I'm kind of trying to dig into there to these things, because I don't think most people have an understanding of psychiatry. I think it's almost like they kind of understand, I guess, a psychologist. It's like this person that you just talked to. But like a psychiatrist, I guess, is more of the treatment aspect almost of it.
Well, what, a psychiatrist has a medical degree. I mean, I went to medical school. I did my surgical rotations and my emergency medicine rotations and so forth. Whereas a psychologist doesn't do that. They
okay.
do more like psychological testing. And they're very good at many of the things they do, but they can't prescribe medicines. They don't understand the full aspect of physiology that a psychiatrist is trained to do.
Okay, so that's one of the things that I've always tried to figure out, the difference between the two. Is, you know, where is the line between the two? And I think a lot of times people don't understand psychiatry, but they also don't understand how to take these types of things that we're talking about and apply it to their martial art, to apply right. it to their shooting, to apply it to right. their fitness. When you talk about the ego, and you talk about the ego and the superego and the external factors, that's a huge thing for people to be able to, not self-diagnose, but to be able to read up and kind of understand how they're viewing the world. I don't think most people yeah. understand how they actually are viewing the world at all. And so they just kind of go right. through day-to-day life almost with no control over what they're doing. It's almost like between the activities they do, between making the coffee, locking the door, you know, doing those types of things that are kind of automatic functions, it's almost like they might not have as much control. And so being able to understand kind of where they come from is a huge thing, you know, whether it's martial art or, you know, whatever it may be.
Absolutely. I think, you know, I had a thought there. It's like we're going to talk about mental models in a little bit, but if you're in the practice of psychiatry or in martial arts, I say, if you're not conscious of a theory or a mental model you're operating with, you're merely unconscious. You're operating with one that's unconscious. You just don't know what it is. So
however you react is what
theater,
you got.
The theater of your mind that you developed biopsychosocially, you know, is going to be different than somebody else's. And so you're operating with that whether you know it or not. And so by becoming more aware of your past, the capacity for self-reflection and in kind of honest to goodness of a humble state of awe about the complexity of our humanity is very important in psychiatry, of course, but it's also very important, in my opinion, in martial arts.
Well, I just had the article that was at Mondurno.com yeah. about, you know, owning the ground you stand on.
Yeah.
And it was funny because Breach Bang Clear, and I've got articles coming out for Breach Bang Clear. They had linked to the article, and they were talking about you know, it's very cerebral, might go over people's heads, you know, when they read this article that was on Moderno. My thing is that it shouldn't. You know, people shouldn't want this information to go over their heads, because this type of information is what governs your day-to-day life. It governs how you're going to react to, you know, your boyfriend, your girlfriend, your spouse, your partner, whatever it is, your kids. This type of stuff governs it, and it also governs your reaction when you get in a fight. You know, yeah. It governs your healing process and how you look at your body when you get an injury. These types of things,
absolutely,
they're vital to survival, you know, the short term and the medium term and long term survival of, you know, the person. If you don't understand them, you're just kind of on autopilot. Now, one of the things that I think it became big back in the martial art community, I want to say early 2000s, was the whole idea of emotional intelligence.
Hmm.
And I think a lot of times people latch on to terms out of the medical world, and they bring it over and not to explain it, but to exploit it. And, you know, I'm much more intelligent because I'm using these terms, you know, and, instead of doing curls, you're doing some type of micro facial, like, you know, muscle contraction or something like that. What is emotional intelligence? Because a lot of people that are listening probably have heard it from somebody that teaches martial art. They've never really understood what it is.
That's a good question. You know, I actually, when you sent me over the outline, I was kind of looking it up and thinking about it, because people have defined it in different ways. I think of it as a capacity to tolerate and to learn from a variety of emotional states, from laughter and humor to industriousness to love and vulnerability and compassion, all the way to the need to defend oneself and one's life and one's loved ones. And the broader of a spectrum that an individual can have, I think that equivocates with emotional and intelligence and emotional health.
So is it about experiencing life and understanding what you're experiencing, yeah, and kind of processing it a little bit differently?
Yes, I think so. And it's like, It's emotional flexibility. You know, in martial arts,
interesting,
we have to do a lot of stretching because we don't injure our bodies. In our emotional life, we have to do a lot. That self-reflection can allow us to emotionally stretch so that we can not be so threatened by, say, more primitive impulses. And that's what martial arts does. We're not threatened as much, and we create mental models to not be threatened by our aggressive impulses, for our aggressive stuff. And we can contain and master those so that we can use them only when we're in danger.
And the more exposure and experience you have to training or fighting or whatever it is, the more flexible you're going to be.
Absolutely. You know, emotionally. You know, right.
Emotionally.
Exactly.
Flexible.
I see, you know, different types of patients, and some people are very conflicted about their aggression. They tend to be people pleasers, and like, they don't want anybody to be mad at them. And you don't see those people in martial arts very much. But sometimes they come to it later. And you see people that are so focused on their anger and their self-protective drive that they can't feel close, and that it can impair their ability to relate in a emotionally compassionate way, because they're so focused on protecting themselves. And then there's people that are so focused on relating closely that they're like, I would say, naive about the fact that there's real aggression in the world and how we deal with it. And I think that pervades on into, like, you know, if you think about political philosophy and the state of the world and international relations and so forth. We won't get into that today, but
no, but I mean, that's
an interesting topic.
Really interesting topic. Most people really aren't going to think about that, you know, and how they interact with the world and that
right.
Flexibility.
I always think, Winston Churchill's one of my great heroes, and he was asked in World War II, which is probably the prime example of a just war, that they should take money that they were spending on the arts and other programs and put it into the war effort. And he looked back at him and he said, "Well, what are we fighting for?" And so it's very interesting. So, I mean, if we protect ourselves and our loved ones because we want to be calm and relaxed and love them and be let our guard down. So that emotional flexibility takes all kinds of dimensions. And I think that's the way I look at emotional intelligence. It's not merely an abstract, 2 + 2 = 4, but ability to shift emotional states without feeling off balance. Like in martial arts, we're shifting stances without being off balance. And if you're off balance, you can't utilize the tools or weapons you have in your disposal. So same thing emotionally, and finding that emotional centeredness or stability.
So let's switch gears a little bit. Let's dig into some training side of things.
Okay.
How people can, now that we've kind of got a little bit of a good baseline of some of these big words you're going to throw out, like what the ego is and so forth. What is signal anxiety? This is something that you actually turned me on to, to really start digging in and studying. What is signal anxiety?
Great question. It also a psychoanalytic concept. I think Anna Freud's daughter, coined the term. But it's basically from the ego, the danger Will Robinson. There's danger that needs to be addressed. Okay, and so how then our psyches and our bodies respond to protecting ourselves against the danger. Now, the danger may be something from the external world, but it also might be a thought or a feeling. So,
can those get confused?
Absolutely. Absolutely.
I mean, you see all the time, well, I don't want to say you see all the time, but, somebody draws their gun. Somebody does something stupid when they shouldn't do it. Is that the outside world telling them there's a danger and them emotionally processing something that isn't there? Like what creates that clenched fist stance with a situation that shouldn't get there?
Great question, Matt. I mean, that's where the rubber meets the road. What is external reality and how are we perceiving it in our psyches and through our eyes and our ears and our senses? And what is inside of ourselves? And that's where the rubber meets the road, in the interface.
And I think it also goes back to that experience that we talked about. All the things, a lot of times when I talk about women's self-defense, one of the first things that you have to do is not teach them to hit somebody with their purse. You got to get in their face and basically, be very abusive with language and smack them around a little bit just to get past all the things that have happened to them so far that create that delay in their response.
Yes.
They have to experience it in a safe environment so that they can go, okay, this is what's happened now. Now I can move beyond it. Dad spanked me when I was a kid. Okay, that doesn't mean that the rapist gets to rape me. I've got to get past that.
Yes.
So you're saying that
that's an ego function. That's a function of a healthy ego to be able to discriminate what external reality is. It's in martial arts, it'd be threat perception. How is this threat? What is the accuracy of our determination of this threat? Is it a real threat? Is it not a threat? What's up? And so you have to use your ego and that emotional flexibility to determine that. And it's not easy.
It's not easy.
No, it's not easy at all. I mean, and you see, signal anxiety tips us off. I mean, I know we're going to talk about post-traumatic stress disorder. That's when the trauma imposed from external reality completely and utterly overwhelms the psyche and the body sometimes, in rape and combat sometimes. And people that go into those situations have different, what we would call pre-morbid function. How did they do before they were raped? Or how did they do before they were in combat? Or these types of psychologically potentially overwhelming situations, which also determines what happens in the manifestation of a condition like post-traumatic stress disorder. When signal anxiety either wasn't there, I mean, psychologically, I see post-traumatic stress disorder as everybody's going back and looking for where was the danger clue that would have helped me avoid this. And so you get stuck in kind of a loop of like, I'm looking, how come I didn't see it? How come I didn't see it? I could have done something. And then the trauma ensued, whatever that trauma might be.
So it's almost, if you end up with post-traumatic stress disorder because a bomb exploded next to you. I mean,
there's none.
You're stuck with the aftermath that there is nothing that you could have done to prevent that short of, I guess you get maybe if I hadn't gone on that patrol, maybe if I hadn't enlisted, right. maybe if I hadn't done this, or, right. you know, if you're an officer and there's a right. shooting, something. Right. But I can see how you would get stuck in that loop instead of right. peeling past that loop and moving yeah, I mean, on to healing it.
Correct. Correct. And it's complex because also in severe post-traumatic stress disorder, there's actual, you know, biological and chemical changes in the brain that come.
That's one of the things Sarah Jameson was talking yes. about. I mean, it changes the brain.
It changes your brain. It's like the groove in the record is worn in. I mean, there's ample scientific literature to show this. But yes, it changes the brain and how you respond. Auditory processing is different. Our sympathetic nervous systems, it's like all of a sudden, essentially our sympathetic nervous system, our burglar alarm is all of a sudden like super sensitive. You don't want to ever miss a signal anxiety again.
But yeah, so that's that past kind of dictating the present yeah. that, you know, that signal anxiety all of a sudden is heightened more than it ever would have been. Right. And you can end up with that emotional reaction instead of, you know, what is actually the physical threat or the physical, you know, obstacle in front of you need to overcome. You can end up with that emotional reaction based off of the previous experience.
Absolutely. And for example, I mean, I had a patient, decorated a combat soldier, I'm trying to make sure I don't divulge. I'm not going to divulge any confidentialities, but had been in combat and seen some pretty severe trauma. In fact, it was a fairly well-known situation, and got through that. Has become, you know, in the martial arts world, quite successful, and went to a movie that triggered his response. So it had violence and explosion, so he went to the movie, and it triggered the physiologic and the psychological reactions of what he'd experienced, and he had a short term of decompensation. He's doing very well, and you know, but it was a short term, but it's probably because he had a pretty good premorbid function and has a lot of good ego function in the here and now, but it completely freaked him out when he saw this particular movie.
And I was talking to somebody a while ago, and we were actually talking about PTSD and, you know, the ego and all those different things, and yeah. They must have gone to like a Scientology location or something like that, because they had such a twisted and strange view of. Now, I mean, you and I have talked about overprescribing drugs yes. and the dangers of things like that. Absolutely. That there is that, you know, the almost a medical industrial complex, like,
yes,
you know, I mean, keep them almost healed so we can keep giving yeah. them drugs.
Just because, you know, the Scientologists say there's greed in the pharmaceutical industry or in a for-profit hospital industry or these types of things. I mean, they're kind of right about that. You know, a busted clock is right twice a day. You know, so, you know, but I think they misinterpret and have all kinds of bizarre delusional theories about what psychiatry is. And so to jump back to medications, medicines definitely can get the best of people sometimes. They don't want to look at their emotional responses and the theater of their own mind that might contribute to it. And sometimes people do not want to take medicines, even though it could substantially reduce unnecessary suffering. So people have all kinds of feelings.
To almost kind of clear out some of those obstacles
right.
to get to the origin instead yeah. of just making the pill or the medicine
right.
the new origin.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah,
this is now this yeah. is my base and I'm just going to work from here because I've got yeah. the pill instead of getting right. back right. to what caused you to have to get the pill.
Yes. Yeah, in essence.
So with signal anxiety, I've got an article coming out about signal anxiety and mental models and so forth. And you got some things in that article, so no. don't.
That's fine.
But we talked about mental models a moment ago. And signal anxiety, it's the burglar alarm. And, you know, it's what tells us to get going. Where does the mental model figure into that? Because mental models, like you said, that's the theater of the mind. And that's, you know, things that have happened to us that, you know, we process and we start to create reactions in our mind. Where does the mental model figure into the signal anxiety? Because signal anxiety is very important. It's going to dictate how we react to situations. Everybody says, and Mark Joseph was funny when he was on from Spartan Training Gear. And I said, okay, you've probably got more experience than anybody in the world and fighting people when it comes to protective gear and putting protective gear on and them feeling safe that they can actually react to you when you attack them. Because they're in a class to, you know, learn this. That's why we had the equipment. Right. How do they react? And he said, not like they think they're going to react. Yeah. You know, very few people do the first time unless they've had that training. So the signal anxiety kicks in.
Right.
And now they have to have that reaction. Where does the mental model figure into that?
I think it's the nexus, it's the interface, the fulcrum of how you're going to respond. I mean, that's why we train. Training allows us a flexibility of responses. I was at a Bondo camp one time, and we were doing some stuff, and one of the most skilled Bondo practitioners that I've ever known, he's a master of one of the animal systems and so forth, he said, there's a big difference between fantasy and function, which is profoundly true in martial arts, be it the empty hand, a stick hand, a blade hand, or even a gun hand. And our mental models can be changed by our training, so we have a flexibility of response. I know, and you can probably share some of your experience too, but when I did some competitive kickboxing and amateur boxing, when you're in the fight, one of the fun parts about it is you become kind of an unconscious based upon your training. You're delivering those blows and shots and kicks and strikes and stepping to bring that into play. But the preparation in terms of the mental models really affect that. It's like when we've trained with Aaron in the simunitions, and like, you know, what was so eye-opening to me is like, and Aaron has written about it very eloquently, you completely lose your sight focus, you know?
Yeah.
And so simunitions brings you to a different level of focus of what it is.
Well, it's the difference between, sharp shooting accuracy and practical accuracy. Practical accuracy, is really getting rounds downrange on a target, what you need to do to be practical for your experience, versus accuracy where people, they really focus in on the sights. And, we know
you just lose
you're not going to be able to focus on the front sight when you end up in a stress shoot or a combat shoot. You have to, especially the initial point. Now you may move to cover, something may happen, then you refocus and you mentally focus on what's happening, and then you get back to your training. Yeah. But, it's the whole thing of, in martial art, you see a lot of guys, they go in and they do everything automatically and they lose, and they get into a loop of just trying to wrestle somebody, trying to grapple somebody, trying to do the same thing over and over until they either get hit right or they get knocked down or something happens and they reset, and then they have to consciously deal with the situation, and then they have the front sight focus for their fighting.
Right.
And that's why one of the things that I've always tried to do is I try to get people past the automatic stage as quick as possible to the conscious stage with training. I give them, big weapons, big targets, very basic when it comes to combatives, very basic things that are automatic that do a lot of damage very quickly to get you to the point of making the decision on what you need to do, versus having so many options that you end up in that loop where you're trying to do stuff, trying to do things. When it comes to combatives, I don't like people to have a lot of options. I'd rather them have very limited, powerful options that work 90% of the time, and then have the conscious mind and the training to be able to see clearly through the fog of the fight to make the decision on what they have to do. And a lot of that comes from not only my personal experience and other people, but also when you do simunitions.
Right.
Because once you realize that you lose things that you've trained for so long, everybody's so sight dependent that I think they forget. When they go to the range, don't look at your sights. See how you do. You do surprisingly well if you've got good body mechanics. Mm-hmm. But going back to
you have to. Yeah, it's great. I love it. It's
we end
question.
Up in the.
You have to free yourself from thought, but be able to step back into thought when you can. You have to be able to move back and forth between
Is that conscious and unconscious?
Yes, you have to be able to, it's that fluidity of process, I think, that what drew me to the martial arts, and I probably maybe you, because it's really where that rubber meets the road. I mean, I remember training in G's backyard one day on a form, and we did the form, and you can know all the moves and all this kind of stuff, but he said, no, we're going to like take one or two moves out of the form. We're going to train him at full speed. You know, like one guy's going to try to kick you, and you're going to do this motion out of the form over and over again. So we're all bruised. We started at like 8 in the morning. It was like 11 at night. He's lighting candles in the backyard. This is when I was young and in good shape, you know, and I was dying. And I remember we went out to dinner for that, and he talked about doing these things unconsciously. And he says, if you start thinking about your mother, the fight is over. And that just stuck with me. And he said, it's not what you know, it's what you can do. And you know, that's like there's some fundamental truth about training for self-protection that speaks to.
I think that's what keeps people in the martial arts so long.
Yeah.
You know, once you get past, you know, being in Taekwondo and you get like your black belt or something, if you're still doing martial arts in your 30s, 40s, and 50s, there's something more than wanting to get in a fist fight there and being young and indestructible. You start to see how much of it actually applies to your everyday non-martial art life. Mm-hmm. You know, people always, oh, what do you do, karate? You got some kind of black belt? Right. And it's like, you have no self-discipline and no self-control. I mean, when you look at the person, you say, okay, you can laugh about me doing martial art, but I've got a lot more control from the lessons that I've learned in martial art over my life than you probably have. Because outside of the military or, you know, boot camp and, you know, law enforcement training or whatever it is, there's not a whole lot of things that give you physical discipline, you know, sports and so forth, that if you don't do those things, you're going to be out there floating, you know, with just your mind trying to discipline itself. And unless you're meditating all the time, your mind will not discipline itself.
Right. It's fantasy and function.
I actually really like that. So before we go to the rapid fire, before we take a little music break and then get into the rapid fire session, what should somebody avoid when developing a mental model? And, you know, folks, you can, on Breach Bang Clear, I've got an article coming out so you can actually read a little bit more in depth about signal anxiety and mental models. And what should someone, I talk about five things that they can do to develop a good mental model, but what's something, one thing somebody should avoid if you had to pick something out?
That when they...
Losing?
Yeah. Well,
I'm going to train to lose.
Yeah, right. That would be a good one. That's one of those, you know, definitive statements. You know, I would think it is always keeping a student mind. I mean, always having a student mind. I mean, you know, if you always remain a student and don't share your knowledge, then, you know, a student who remains only a student disrespects his teacher. But you also have to keep that humble mind, because I'm humbled every day. I mean, and when we go to we have at the weapons camp for Bondo coming up, everybody wears a white humility belt. I mean, it's, you know, belts just to hold your pants up anyway, you know, so, you know, but it's like, you have to think about that open mind and don't assume that when you've arrived at a model that it can't change and grow. That, like,
we've seen it
change
for people.
Yeah,
you know, so many
based
times
on new experiences. And so, you know, seek out people with different perspectives. Engage them. That's our whole. Anyway, I'll get a little political. Our country's lost sight of learning from people of different perspectives. And everybody's like, I think you said it once so well. The United States perpetual outrage.
Yep.
Can't we?
That's what I call it.
You know, and that's not a healthy ego function as a group. You know, we need to talk about these things because, you know.
The thing is,
complex.
And it's something that you talked about one time. You know, being part of the herd.
Yeah.
You know, that. People want to be part of the herd. They've got to be part of the herd. I've got to, everybody has to look, I'm just like you. We all belong together. And you know, it's like when we're kids, when I was a kid, I wanted to be, you know, punk is bad word. You know, I wanted to be punk rock. I didn't want to be part of the herd. Right. Back then it was all about how could you be different?
Yes.
Everybody, you know, even if you were on the football team, you wanted to be different from the rest of the guys on the football team because you were better than them, or you did something this, or you had this girlfriend. Now it seems like with the selfie nation that everything has to be filtered the right way. Everything has to look the right way. Everything. And so then eventually you quit learning.
Right.
From other people, because it's like, but you're not like me.
And it's, I think it's kind of,
you don't fit in my selfie.
It's difficult in the martial arts. I mean, psychologically, I guess you'd call it spiritually. I mean, to be constantly open to learning new things, because when you get identified with one way of doing it, you can over-identify. It takes that emotional flexibility and emotional intelligence to think, okay, I'm going to prepare and develop mental models and physical responses based upon my training to prepare for danger. But to admit you don't have everything requires a certain amount of emotional maturity and emotional vulnerability, you know, to say,
yep,
I don't know at all. So I learned that from my studies in jazz guitar. I love jazz, and I play the guitar, and I'm moderately decent jazz guitarist. But somebody once said to me, this very esteemed guitar player, said, listen more than you play. So when you're playing, you know, jazz is improv. Yeah. And then when you're fighting, it's improv.
Yeah.
So you're kind of paying attention and being fluid more than you're kind of acting. And so as we train, I try to think, what am I learning? And how am I...
I think we're...
Keep that student mind is just what I'm trying to say.
I think we're learning a lot on this episode of Pramek Radio. I mean, it's pretty incredible. So we're going to take a quick music break, then come back with the rapid fire session with Dr. Brad Johns. All right, and we are back with the rapid fire session. So, Dr. Johns, I'm just going to ask you a bunch of questions. And I see you over there getting prepped, drinking your...
It's like free association. I got to respond off the cuff. That's going to be interesting.
All right.
Let's do it.
Favorite car?
Corvette.
Because you...
Race Corvettes, yeah.
Yeah, you race Corvettes.
Well, I'm just a hobbyist, you know, but I love to go fast in my Corvette.
Fastest you've ever gone?
In my car, about just shy of 160. In my friend Matt's car, probably 185.
Isabel?
Yeah.
What car was it?
Oh, he's got this monster, totally custom raced Datsun Z car.
Oh, I've seen photos of that. Okay.
It's unbelievable. He's a great driver, too.
So, 180?
Probably, yeah.
No thanks.
Yeah.
I got to be in a plane for that. I can barely go over. Like Jeff Bramstead said, I have a very strong sense of self-preservation, all the way to the point of going over 100 miles per hour in a car.
Feeling a car in the turn at the limits of traction, and then sometimes beyond, because I've spun it out a couple of times, is an unbelievable thrill.
Well, I guess I'm going to be coming out to y'all's course and doing it. Favorite type of pizza?
My Dagwood's Deluxe near where I live. It's got a little bit of everything on it. I just don't like pineapple or sardines.
Favorite pistol?
My Glock 19.
Do you have a favorite ammo?
No.
Nothing that you carry specific to it?
Federal.
Just federal?
Yeah, just that federal.
Most famous person you've ever met?
Pat Metheny. Who? He's a jazz guitarist, at least one I was most excited about. Okay. That just pops into my mind right now.
Have you ever seen something in the martial arts that you couldn't explain that somebody said it was chi or ki or something like that?
I have not.
Really?
No.
There we go.
I haven't seen it. Maybe it's there. I just haven't seen it.
Huh. Have you ever had nobody's ever done anything to you or anything like that you couldn't explain?
In the martial arts?
Yeah.
No.
No, you said in the martial arts, so...
If somebody ever done something to me that I can't explain...
Like, you know, that you could attribute to chi or ki or psychic energy or something like that.
Well, psychic energy is kind of a mysterious, you know, force, like the ether or something. I don't really take a lot of credence in that. I mean...
No, it's fine. It's fine.
I had a girl break up with me once when I was young. I can't explain that, you know. That's right.
Well, there we go. Are you more of a kicker or a puncher?
Puncher. My boxing skills were much better than my kicking skills.
Okay.
I had a good solid round kick to the leg and lower body, but I was never a good high kicker.
Favorite place you've traveled to?
Thailand.
Okay. There we go. It's always people always like give answers, and that's the great thing about rapid fire is that you just throw them out there and people, they answer them, and then you process it and you go, well, yeah, you do a lot of martial arts. Makes sense. Okay. Favorite cereal growing up?
Favorite what?
Cereal.
Cereal. Life.
What's the one thing that you would change about Harvard since you went to Harvard?
About Harvard? What would I change about Harvard? God, Lord. I mean, I'm speechless. It was too cold. The winters are, I lived in the north for 10 years in Philly, Boston, Cleveland, and I fled back south. I mean, it is unreal cold up there.
Oh, I was up there once, and I had just shaved my head, and
yeah.
I thought I was going to pass out. I was walking in a parking lot, going to a meeting, and I'm walking with these three guys, and they're from there. And I just took off running.
Yeah, it's just insane. And they, like, minus 10.
I got to the door, and I got inside, and they walked up, and they were like, why were you running? I was like, cause it's cold as hell out here. Like, I don't know how you people deal with this. Yeah. I forgot my hat.
Yeah, when I first went there, I was in New Orleans and Atlanta. I came up there, and I was like, when it got cold here in Atlanta, I just put my hands in my pockets. And I went to Boston, and by like the end of November, my hands were like cracked and bleeding because it was so cold. You've got to have gloves, and I just didn't know that. So talk about mental models changing my worldview. It's like, oh, this is cold, you know?
So, I've had people, when I lived down in South Georgia, they'd move down there or whatever, and they couldn't understand the humidity. They couldn't move.
Yeah.
And be like, I can't move. I don't want to do anything. I can't go outside. I can't get any work done. I don't want to walk to the car. This is terrible. And I'm like, well, that's the same thing that I feel like when I go to where you're from, which is negative 10. And the coldest I've ever been in was, I think it was about negative 20 in Moscow.
Yeah. Yeah.
And it didn't even make sense.
Right.
At that point, you just go, I don't even know what to say.
Right. Like, I've been in minus 20 in Cleveland. And I can remember people would say, well, once it gets below about 10 degrees, it's all the same. That is a lie.
Yeah, no, it's like the seismic scale. It's like an earthquake.
I know you did a lot of time in Russia and training, you know, and a lot of your roots are from there. And I remember when I was at Harvard, there was this Russian couple that had come in, they were studying, and they would take their babies and they would wrap them up and they would put them in their little crib or cradle right outside the door. And they believed it would toughen them up. Then I remember thinking, they're going to freeze to death. But they didn't. You know, I guess they knew what they were doing, you know.
They call it tempering.
Yeah.
Tempering.
Well, there's actually some truth to that. Cell membranes do adapt to cold climes based upon the amount of cholesterol in the cell membrane. So there is some truth to tempering. I mean, I don't know how much it is. I mean, it's kind of...
It's not enough that I continue to do it. Yeah.
It still freezes to death.
It's not enough that I continue to do it. I just... No thanks. I don't feel like doing it.
Yeah.
And that's it. That's the rapid fire. You nailed every single one of them. That's why I had to come out of left field with the one thing that nobody
cold. It's just cold, man.
Ever expects.
Yeah. I'd never live in the north again unless they paid me like a stupid amount of money.
So we're going to come back after this music break, and we're going to be talking about applying more of this knowledge to training and some things that, you know, are a little bit uncomfortable to talk about in the martial art and firearms world, but definitely need to be talked about. With Dr. Brad Johns on Pramek Radio. A long time ago, we were at a seminar, and you said something to me that horrified me. You said that, I think
one out of every 100 people are schizophrenic or something like that. And so next time that I'm on 285, the big loop around Atlanta, just look around. So that's a generally accurate statement.
That's an accurate epidemiological statistic, yes. But I want to say that the vast, vast majority of people with mental illness live safe, although suffering sometimes desperate lives. So the vast majority of people with mental illness.
So what
gets a rare situation? So statistically speaking, it's kind of like, since this is a martial arts, I'm talking about guns a little bit. How many are there? 300 million firearms in the United States and 400 million people? The vast majority of people of guns don't hurt anybody. We get the kind of a combination. And so there's all kinds of misconceptions and fantasies rather than truths about firearms. And there's all kinds of fantasies and fear of mental illness. Everybody harbors within themselves a fear of their own going crazy or whatever that means. And so that comes out in all kinds of ways. But the vast majority of people with schizophrenia live safe but difficult lives.
So if we take the weapon out of it, the firearm, the knife, the pipe bomb, the car, whatever it may be, if we take that out of it and we look at it, we consistently, you know, find that there's a small minority that are, to use a non-medical term, psychotic. They're the people that use the guns, the knives, the pipe bombs, the, you know, the cars to just act out and run people over.
Right.
How do they end up at that point, I guess? Is it something that outside of just drugging them up for the rest of their lives and making sure that they always take their pill that we're never going to be able to take care of? Because that's the thing that in the martial art world, in the firearms world, everybody's always looking for the lone wolf, the quote lone wolf. And I think there's so much misconception out there that, oh God, they're on Prozac, they're gonna kill everybody. Like, I think there's so much misconception that we have to kind of cut through that so we can see the reality of it, so that we can begin to actually process on, you know, what we know and what we can identify, the things that we can really start to process so that we can make this knowledge actionable for our own defense.
Yes. You know, it's really the untreated people with mental illnesses that are untreated with proper medications used, you know, effectively and judiciously that worry me more than the people that are on the medicines. And the famous example is about 10 years ago, a big study came out of the UK, roughly 3,400 adolescents and young adults, saying that the SSRIs, Prozac, Paxil, that family, caused some suicidal ideations in this population. Well, in that group of 3,400 people, not one of them actually killed themselves. And what happened was, with that information, which was a real statistical phenomenon, that there was an increase in suicidal ideations, it got to the FDA, and the FDA decided in a vote of 15-8, not unanimous, to put a black box warning on these medications. Okay, so all of a sudden, everybody's informed that the possibility of suicidal ideation could occur. And it was real, and they were informing the public. What do you think happened to the number of antidepressant prescriptions after that black box warning came out?
No idea.
Well, they went down. People were more worried about prescribing them. What do you think happened to the suicide rate in it went up?
Went up.
And that's been well documented. So that's always a sticky wicket, you know. Medicines can, you know, help schizophrenia and psychotic illness tremendously. Lithium and Depakote and Zyprexid, Seroquel, and Clozaril can give people literally lives that they wouldn't have otherwise. I mean, they're miraculous. Antidepressants and treating depression, it can be literally life-saving. I mean, you know, suicides are, you know, what, 35,000 people a year commit suicide.
But I guess then people look at the kid up in Newtown, out in Aurora, places like that what do we do what do we do as people walking around? I mean, other than training and being prepared, but I guess most people, and I never really understood it until talking to you, most people really don't understand the basis of how that person can exist, that there's something that evil.
Yeah.
If I can use that term.
I mean,
at a certain point, you know, I mean, but most people don't understand how that exists.
Psychosis does not mean dangerousness. If for anybody that's interested, and I just mentioned this to Aaron a while back, there's an unbelievable documentary called The Psychiatrist and the Iceman, in which Park Dietz, who's a very famous forensic psychiatrist, interviews the guy that was the mafia hitman. He's not psychotic at all, but he's extraordinarily personality disordered. So there's all kinds of psychodiagnostic differences in people that perpetrate violence. And they cannot be psychotic. They can be personality disordered, all kinds of motives and so forth. I don't know. When I live my daily life, I've trained. I like training. I have a carry permit. I carry. But not every single day. Am I at risk? Probably. But statistically speaking, 450,000 people every year die of cigarette-related deaths. Only 10,000 people are killed by guns and homicides. So that's a huge difference. So
yeah, I don't.
You know,
I had this conversation with somebody the other night that they were like, "You don't carry every day?"
Yeah.
No, because there's a responsibility to carrying that means I don't get to have a drink.
That's
and I
correct.
Want to go
it's
out
a huge
to dinner
responsibility
and
a
have a
huge
drink.
Huge responsibility.
So I'm not going to go to the ghetto and have a drink. I'm going to go to the area of town where I'm probably not going to be accosted. And, you know, now I will keep it. It's always with me somewhere in the car that I'm not going to identify to the general public.
Yes.
But, you know, most of the time it's with me. It's not always on me. But if I'm in an area of town if I'm off Boulevard – and I've got to stop at the Texco, which never happens because I'm never on E. But if I was on.
Yeah.
But when I'm at the Publix in East Cobb,
right,
it's probably going to be in the car. Yeah. It's that responsibility. And I think sometimes a lot of people are very, very, very – and this is something that I actually edited out of last week's podcast. A lot of people are – everything about them is identified with the gun, with the martial art, with the knife. Mm-hmm. Every little thing that they look over at other people and they're like, man, look at those hippies. All they care about is anti-war. Their whole life is anti-war. And it's like your whole life is about fitness and working out or something. Right. So
I hear everybody has that. Chemical dependency patients, somebody will come in the hospital. They've been using meth and crack and so forth. And you want to give them a medicine to help them sleep that's been studied well and it's, you know, it's safe and effective and do it for a little bit. And they go, I'm not putting that in my body. And you're like, well, you've been putting everything else in your body, you know? So I think going back to this ego functioning and healthy flexibility, when we polarize our thinking, we lose a student mindset, I think. So if we over-identify with one side or the other, can't we entertain for a while a difference of opinion and it not be a threat? And so that's the flexibility emotionally that I think, you know, helps us to think about whatever the stances are about mental illness. And usually education is the best answer to that. Not always, but education and learning is a good.
So do you think that now there was a UPS shooting yesterday?
Yeah.
In Birmingham, three or four shot. And when they opened, the reports were when they opened the guy's car, there's packed cigarettes, bottle of Xanax, and a bottle of Prozac.
Yeah.
So.
Were the bottles empty? If he ran out of his medicines and his cigarettes, he might have been more irritable.
You know, the thing is that it's out there.
Yeah.
It's not going away. The only way you could get rid of it is you would have to have a police state where anybody that used, basically everybody got tested for any type of mental illness. And if it existed in any way, shape, or form, you'd lock them up and then you'd have to look at the genetics. It's never going away. So the question becomes, how do we start to look at that and then look at our training and things like that?
Yeah.
Knowing that
that's out there. It's not the training that you can do where you can go, this is what happens if somebody mugs you. Right. This is what happens if a guy tries to rape you. Right. It's a completely different kind of mindset to deal with that.
Yeah. Is the world a dangerous place? I would say yes, it can very well be a very dangerous place. And with certain freedoms come certain responsibilities. You know, it's not like Spider-Man or something. But, you know, but it's just true. You know, that's why it hits a real fundamental chord. So how dangerous is the world we live in? You know, and how dangerous is it in any given situation? How we assess that danger? Because you can go in a, you know, you could go to like, you know, one of these, you know, jumpy jump places where kids are all happy and a bad thing could happen. Sure. But it might not. Chances are it won't. So how do you, it's like going to the beach and going swimming. Are you going to have a shark attack, you know, or not? You know, how do you determine how dangerous it is? You know, I wouldn't want to go out to the California coast or South Africa or Australia and get on a surfboard and paddle with like seal flippers. You know, I wouldn't want to do that. But, you know, when I go down to the beach in Florida, I'm going to get in the water.
So it's more about the recognition that it can happen. I think you just have to you really have to look at the intelligences out there. What kind of attacks happen when these people that are mentally ill, what are they generally, the general propensity for, you know, what do they have? What do they attack with? What do they do? And then you have to prepare yourself with the means within, you know, your legal means to prepare yourself for that type of attack.
Right.
And be prepared for it.
Right. And at least for me, the benefits of training and preparing and thinking about it can help you be more adequately and accurately prepared rather than either overreacting or underreacting to potential dangers. It's a routine thing in my hospital stuff where people have access to guns. And are they, you know...
No! Guns are evil.
I mean, I've got a patient that's has been extraordinarily psychotic and has a small arsenal at his house. And when he's not psychotic, you couldn't even tell he had an illness. But when he is, oh my Lord. Well, I've had family members call me, what should we do about the guns? And I'm like, my confidentiality, I can't talk to the family member because he's not sick. If he's sick, then there's all kinds of forensics dimension to the situation. And when you were talking earlier, maybe I'm not a trained forensic psychiatrist. I do some forensic work on the side. Mostly in terms of hospital operations, but there's a whole thing. The policeman at the elbow rule, in terms of the ability to understand if their action was right or wrong. So if it had been the case that a policeman was at their elbow, would they have done the action?
Okay.
And that's kind of – it might be the McNaughton rule. There's all kinds of forensics names for cases and precedent-setting stuff. And so if someone – even if the policeman was the elbow, they believed – that person was possessed by the devil and they had to shoot them, then their chances of being declared criminally insane are greater because they – and I don't know how this
– No, it makes sense.
I don't consult with the courts. I've got some very good friends that do that and so forth. But that interface between psychiatry, the law, and criminal behavior is fascinating. It can be pretty difficult to practice because you see a lot of pretty serious stuff.
Has your medical practice changed the way that you train? The things that you've seen, the patients that you've worked with and so forth, has it changed, you know,
my training in the martial arts?
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, I think about stuff like, you know, it crosses my mind, and I think it's a good thing that it crosses my mind that people that could be upset and angry with me for reasons that I just don't see. Psychiatrists do not have crystal balls. That's truth number one. We can't foresee everything. The psychiatrist up in Pennsylvania that saved, my opinion, saved his own life when someone was trying to kill him by pulling his firearm out and firing back.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, and interesting enough, I had a lot of discussion with my hospital administrators that the hospital actually didn't distance themselves and supported them. I mean, it was how was the hospital going to handle that, you know, and what the situation is? Because it's a possibility.
How can you get to the point of being so politically, not you, the royal you, we, being so politically correct that somebody should die rather than defend themselves? Because we had this idea of, oh, you're a doctor. You know, I mean, it's a weird thought process.
The Hippocratic Oath is do no harm.
Yeah.
I mean, I think we had a conversation with how did I phrase it? You know, I'm here to help you when I'm in my doctor role, and I will do whatever I can to help you. But as soon as you pose, and this is where I have to think, if someone poses a lethal threat to me or mine, then I'm going to go in. It's I'm no longer going to like jeopardize my own life. I would defend myself.
Yeah.
Yeah.
There's so many people out there that's
when it's not like
what it comes down to.
I'm not going to wait for your therapy to work. Or something.
Yeah. Just wait till the next session. And if you need to come back and kill us all, I've had
colleagues who've patients have brought loaded guns to the session and they talk about it and said, well, why don't I hold it for you? Why don't I hold it for you? We can talk or see what's going on. And it's, I don't guess there's any one right way to do with it or wrong.
I think it gets back to what we talked about earlier, being the people just have this, it's not even black and white view of the world. It's like rainbows out of a unicorn's ass view of the world you took the Hippocratic Oath. Yeah. So you should die because you could never.
Right.
It's like, I just watched a video and they're making a huge thing about it. Yeah. You know, NYPD pushes down pregnant woman. They're trying to arrest her son who has a knife. She runs up and is getting in the middle of it. The guy turns around and pushes her down to get her out of the way. And now it's, man, these cops sure are militarized. They're killing everybody. They're going to strip your rights. It's like, it's this weird viewpoint of the world. And that's why I hate looking at the news. That's why it's all personal minutia to the things that I... Is having a lot of guns cool? Yeah. But I don't need... I mean, I say personally, now somebody that's a collector and so forth, go for it. Buy all the guns you want. Right. I mean, I think you can have, you know, 50 cal or whatever.
Yeah.
For me, going out and buying a P90, even though it's really cool, or going out and buying a SCAR or, you know, something like that is really cool. To me, it's personal minutia. It's getting in the way of me getting really good on the guns that I need. Mm. And there's other things in my life that I could be doing, like writing a book, writing magazine articles, running a podcast, doing things like that, that I don't choose to tie myself down to those things. People get that viewpoint of the world that, you know, this is the way everything has to be. Boy, we are tangent prone today on this episode.
Of emotional, I guess it can be a sense of
the flexibility,
emotional safety by having a unity of purpose. I mean, you know, you can go back and do political philosophy through the course of the world and watch, you know, people get rally around an idea. Which, you know, look at the Nazis, and they damn near conquered the world. You know,
yeah.
So, I mean, and so there's real danger, but it's when do you? When do you respond to the threat, and how accurately have you determined, and when do you not?
Well, when do you live
in the moment?
Live it. Well, you know, is paranoia conscious or unconscious?
Right. Yeah.
I don't know because when do you live your life and when do you live in paranoia?
In paranoia, when I see people with, say, paranoid schizophrenia, I mean, they believe that someone has planted, you know, a chip in their brain and is monitoring every thought.
That's what I don't mean to laugh.
It's true. I mean,
it's just incredible that
a big paper came out a couple of days ago about the 8 different genetic subtypes of schizophrenia. You know, we've mapped the human genome. 15 years ago, it cost $3 billion to do it. Now they can do it about 2 weeks for, you know, $20,000.
Yeah, pocket change.
So what they're doing and understanding the genetic basis of these type of brain diseases, you know, it's a natural phenomenon run amok. If we didn't have a sense of vigilance, signal anxiety, and biology that could respond to that, we wouldn't have evolved from, you know, whatever we evolved from. We would have been like kind of outcompeted with another species or something. So that paranoia in schizophrenia is just a natural phenomenon run amok, you know, and it's overrepresented in the genome, which then becomes the genotype and phenotype. I won't go into all of what's represented in the individual organism.
So let's shift gears.
Yeah.
The great thing is that you live locally, so I can always have you back.
Oh, I'd love to. This is great.
Firearms.
Yeah.
You did a long time in Bondo and everything else, using different weapons.
How do you view the firearm in, you know, in your training context? Because a lot of people, they in the martial art community, the traditional martial art community, the firearm's like this strange thing to them. I think a little bit. It's almost a betrayal of, you know, their regular weapons or the things that they would do. And then people overseas in countries where you can't have them, they don't even know why we like them.
Right.
You know, they know they want one, but why did you take up firearms?
I think for me, it was like my body was the hip and the knee and the surgery was starting to fail. And I was thinking, and I changed my mental model. I mean, I was thinking, well, all I need is my kukri knife and my kickboxing skills and I'll be safe. Well, that was a falsehood. If you're going to, Gio, I said, it's a martial system, not a martial art. So it's a system of responding to the world and self-protection. And we have the animal systems in Bondo. The primary purpose of the American Bondo Association is to honor the veterans. That's the primary purpose. But in the animal systems, we pay tribute to the survival instinct in all things. So we have nine animals, you know, the python, the viper, the cobra, the tiger, so forth. And to get into that survival instinct. And so in paying tribute to that. So guns have been invented. They're out there. And I think it would be, my take was, well, I'm getting old. I can't do a whole lot to protect myself anymore as I get older and more infirm. But as a martial artist, I think you're limiting yourself. It's the emotional flexibility. Let me go learn about, Aaron said my first day, he said, why are you here? I said, to learn the safe operation of a firearm to protect myself and my family. And that's right. That's how I feel about that. But I wanted to learn from somebody that knew what they were doing and took it very seriously. As I undertook that responsibility, because, you know, people do accidentally kill themselves with firearms. I have to keep them ultra safe. I mean, you know, and so the possibility of an accident outweighs for me sometimes having the gun more accessible. And that's the choice I make, you know, because, you know, a kid's neurodevelopment, a child, you know, at 12 or 13, our brains don't really completely wire up in our frontal lobes until we're about 26. You know, so impulse control and all kinds of things is different for the young adult and adolescent than it is for the...
Well, there's no way you could usually get somebody that's 32 to go off and, you know, get killed.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
I was thinking the other day as I get older, that's why old people drive slow, because they know all the bad shit that can happen.
Yep. And I was talking to a friend of mine the other day, and we were talking about the fact that, you know, that the brain doesn't develop, you know, until you're mid-20s, especially in boys.
Right.
Exactly. It takes longer.
Right.
And I told her, I said, because there's no way at this point for me to go out and do, I got to have a cause. I really have to have a reason for me. But you take an 18-year-old that's brain isn't fully developed, they will go and do things that older people won't, you know, that they might not do it as well because they don't have that experience, but they're not wired up completely yet.
Put the brakes
all
on
the reasoning and
primitive brain, you know. So I knew a guy who was a DA once in DeKalb County, and he said, oh my, and he carried his weapon when he went out with the police, and he was a DA. Do things, and he said, oh, I would much rather be accosted by a 35-year-old guy with a gun than a 15-year-old with a gun. That's what he said. And I just think about it neurologically. the 15-year-old is more likely to shoot you.
And so you said the primitive brain.
Yeah, the primitive brain, because the frontal lobes kind of wire up and they give us our executive functioning, like rational decision-making, conscious thought. It's the more evolutionary recent parts of the brain. Our reptilian brain is the one that's, you know, like the amygdala. Aaron's writing a lot about the amygdala and fear processing, emotional responses, and so forth. And so all those circuits, the frontal lobe can kind of, it's the philosopher king of our brain, if you would, you know, where it can reason and think and, you know, delay gratification and check impulses that might come out.
Back to what we originally talked about the ego and the id and everything that.
I give them a lot of kudos for taking on this topic of, you know, brain development and you too, the neurology of martial arts and training as a, you know, a police
people
officer.
For
it takes a great amount of responsibility to take on that topic.
People, in a lot of ways, they just want to keep doing it. Like I always say with the CLM, when Dr. Landry and I developed it. The goal of it was because he had developed all the adult learning for Florida Post and all these different things. And the goal of it wasn't to teach a student, it was to teach the teacher, because teachers had no idea how their students were learning. They had no idea the processes that were going on. They had no idea to test their skill.
Right.
They had no idea how their relationship with the student was affecting the student and the training environment and the other students. No clue. I mean, and so we started working on it because everybody was being taught like they were taught, but nobody was teaching them to teach. So it was, well, this is the way that we've always done things. And it's like, but nobody, you're not keeping students for more than 6 months and your system's not growing. You that might have been the way that it happened, but you were taught by this master that he's learned all these different, he's teaching you a bunch of holds and moves and things like that, but he's not teaching you how
to
teach
it. Making the object of science, the scientific study, the teaching itself, rather than, that's conscious and unconscious models. I'm just doing it like my teacher showed me.
Yep.
As opposed to like, how are we breaking this down? What is the science? Science is a methodology. Science is not about espousing a dogma. Science is like, let's make a hypothesis and let's test that hypothesis and see what results come back. And then we can ascertain the results. And that's the student mindset. The science, in my opinion, should be a very humble enterprise. But it can make positive statements about what is happening, and making the object of scientific study the learning of martial arts is really going to be a jump.
Trust me,
we're doing this.
It is. Like, that's all I do.
You know, Master so and so said this, and you know, we have to weigh that. I mean, in how we're learning, and people learn differently. And that's, you know.
Well, I mean, it's one of the toughest things that at Pramek that we face, but it's also one of the reasons that we've grown exponentially, like we have, is because we look at we step back. Like I said, if I'm teaching combatives, you're going to learn, you know, things that they're 90 percenters. They work 90% of the time, you know, big weapons, big targets, you know, a lot of aggression, intelligently done for your body type and your size. And, you know, that's how we're going to do it. But once you get beyond that to master what you're doing and to understand the levers and the screws and the equilibrium and, you know, all the strategy, all these different things, the neurology. Nobody ever approaches neurology in martial art training, and it's how people learn martial art.
Right.
But people would rather say, oh, I'm badass. I just beat that guy up and wrestled with him. And, you know, this guy's my teacher because he's won 15 fights. He can't teach you shit other than what he's done, but he's won 15 fights. That makes him a teacher. No. You know, it's much more expansive than that. And it's why the traditional martial arts have died off like they have. There was I truly believe that, you know, there was a karate school on every corner back in the 70s and 80s. Then all of a sudden,
Enter the Dragon.
Yeah. Everybody was about the Karate Kid. It was a huge thing. And then with the introduction of UFC, the traditional martial art world did not adapt. Mm-hmm. UFC took it all, put it all on display, and mixed martial art, you know, it was the tough man contest. It was down at the local bar at the honky tonk that people were fighting for $50. They put it up there. They marketed it right. And then they started creating mixed martial art in their schools.
Yeah.
Traditional martial art had no counter to that.
Right.
Because you could go there and you could kick, you could punch, you could wrestle, you could do everything. Right. But at the kung fu school, you had to kick and you had to do, you know, the dragonfly form.
Yeah.
They didn't push beyond with a new way of teaching to keep people beyond those first couple of years. So now what I think you have in the traditional martial art world is that you've got a lot of people that are over 35 and 40 and 50.
Yeah.
And that new generation's all going to the mixed martial art world because there was nothing there that really captured their imagination. And it's funny, I look at the firearms world, you know, which I'm obviously involved in, and nobody knows martial art.
Yeah.
No, everybody can shoot a gun fast as anybody's business. But if I get within 2 feet of you, 3 feet of you, I'm going to destroy you because you have no idea how to truly defend yourself.
Yeah. Right.
You know how to project. You know how to pull a trigger to put a bullet in a target that's 25 feet away.
Right.
You have no idea what to do if I come up and I grab you. You're going to go back to primitive man.
Right.
You know, claw, scratch, bite.
Yeah. You're going to try to bench press it away.
Yeah.
as opposed to having more flexible response.
Yeah, right. And it's that emotional flexibility, you know, to look at, or that, you know, the emotional intelligence to go, okay, maybe I'm not. And I think it's growing. And I think, you know, myself being out there, and I know Dom Rosso out, you know, talking about martial art, you know, and you got people like Kelly McCann who's on in 2 weeks. I think the firearms world's starting to see maybe they don't know as much as they think that they know when it comes to self-defense, because they're very, you know, it's not multifaceted.
Right.
You got people and they teach the knife. And so then you have a bunch of people that are relying on a knife.
Right.
So they went from the gun to the knife. They went to two things that can kill them if it's turned around.
Right.
Nobody has ever killed me by grabbing my fist and punching me in my own face with my, you know, I've never kicked my own ass because somebody grabbed my leg and started kicking me with it.
Well, it's you know, Bonnie, we talk about it's the empty hand, the stick hand, the blade hand,
yep,
and the gun, and you could say the gun hand.
I think.
And so the more flexible you are with that, you have options for empty-handed techniques, and it's most of the Bondo system is like you learn the basic empty-handed stuff: the stepping, the body movements, the blocks, the punks, the strikes, the kicks, and then you do them empty-handed, and you get into like a maybe pick one of the animal systems, and then you put a stick in your hand, and most
that's exactly
the same
how
thing.
I yep.
And then you put a blade in your hand. The motions are the same. You just have a blade in your hand.
Yep.
And when I did the first defensive handgun fundamentals with Aaron, everybody was doing, and I've read it with some interest, his forward isosceles versus modified Weaver. Because I essentially would fight in a modified Weaver stance, and I still shoot that way.
Yep.
I feel more comfortable in a modified Weaver. Now, I'll try to do forward isosceles, and it just feels
well, there's
too.
A lot of people that'll tell you, you know, you shouldn't shoot in that because nobody uses it. The thing is that you were doing martial art before most of these people could legally even own a gun.
Right.
So you're training to be able, if you, I'm going to piss people off, but I don't care. There's so many people that are so reliant on the gun that I hope that they never go to Europe and get mugged because they'll be effed. They'll have no idea what to do because you can't have your gun over there. And so when people tell a martial artist, you got to do it this way, this is part of something that the way that I punch is the way that I use a knife.
Yeah.
It's how I use a stick. Everything is integrated. I always talk about that, you know, science is the letters, and the letters make up the sentences. The sentences make up the paragraphs. Paragraphs make, you know, pages. Pages make books. If I don't have the movement down, I can't advance beyond. I'm also going to confuse my neurology by throwing all these different things at it. And what's it going to go back to? It's going to go back to what I've done longest. Now, you do Bondo once, twice a week. Yeah. You shoot once a month. What do you think your body is going to go back to? It's gonna, so you have to take what you do most commonly and adapt your system around it. The way that I move with a firearm, when it comes to getting off the ground, getting on the ground, moving with a firearm, I move completely different than everybody, but I smoke them on the line and I'm faster because I was doing this 15 years ago and they just started doing it a couple of years ago. And so people don't look at that neurology. They just go, well, this is the way that I'm supposed to do it. Well, if you've never done anything else, that's fine. But there's always this, and it's the same thing with the mixed martial art crowd and the UFC crowd, looking at traditional people and being weird about us because we do things differently.
I was thinking of my philosophy training, but like, you know, it's a bit of a Copernican revolution, you know, Copernican revolution in thinking in the martial arts, where it's like, you know, for how long did people believe that the earth was the center of the universe? They found that it was the sun, you know, so they had to, based upon new evidence, oh my God, but that took about a long time. I mean, they were going to kill Galileo for it, and he said, okay, I take it back. He saved his life. It wasn't much of a good life after that, but at least, you know, these types of things. So in looking at these types of things and being able to evaluate learning in martial arts and a diversity and a flexibility, I think, you know, it can awaken people from their dogmatic slumbers.
And I think
which
it is
another Kantian phrase, you know, and from the history of philosophy, but dogmatic slumbers can easily set in. That's what we've been talking about in mental models and childhood development and psychiatry and so forth. And bringing that to the martial arts and shooting and firearms. I mean, there's a lot to be learned from people that do different stuff.
I think more people are starting to realize that, and Paul Van Dunk and I were talking about this, that, all right, the gear is cool, but except for, it's like one of my teachers in Russia said, the gun that saves your life is not going to be your tricked out Glock or your M4. It's going to be the old 1864 shotgun that's above the fireplace when, you know, you're at your parent-in-law's house and somebody breaks in and you're sleeping on the couch or on the pull-out bed. That's the one. So, you know, it's...
There was no signal anxiety for that, by the way.
It's one of those things that, you know, the gear isn't as cool as it was. Right. And people... And being trick shooters and really fast shooters isn't as cool as it was. People are starting to remember, and I think they're starting to remember in the martial art community, why they're here, which is to defend yourself.
Yeah.
And if you're going to defend yourself, that's a little bit different thought process than sparring and kickboxing.
Right.
It's a different fighting style. Right. It's not to say that sparring kickboxing is bad. It's to say, hold on, we got to look at this over here and have that flexibility.
That's right. I mean, because it's, you know, the one thing that my time in competition from like kind of what we call middle style, which is like kind of like a little more rigorous points. It's not really a point system, but there's no, you can't knock people out. Then moving up to kickboxing, when you're doing your techniques, you have gloves, you have headgear on and all these
things. You will do things that you would never do without.
Right. And you're trying to knock somebody out. Yeah. So it takes it up to a whole nother level of sympathetic activation. Yeah. You're trying to not get knocked out that gives your training. But a real fight for your life is going to be a lot different.
That's one of the things that Mark Joseph talked about was that when he puts on the Spartan gear and you don't have any gear on and he puts it on and then he acts like a criminal. He shows that aggression. You can see it in his eyes and his face. You can feel the body language. You can feel the energy. Everything is there.
Oh, there's a famous experiment in social psychology. I think it was done in California where they had people from Berkeley or one of these very prestigious university. One group of people was going to be the prison guards, and one was going to be the guards. And after about 2 weeks, they had to stop the experiment because people were over-identifying with the roles.
Yep.
I mean, it's a hallmark experience. It's like, you know, I think of like how our childhood affects us. Harry Harlow's monkeys, the wire mesh mother. Anybody that's ever taken abnormal psychology, they raise monkeys, rhesus monkeys, with wire mesh mothers and real monkey mothers. And of course, the monkeys that had real mothers did better socially than the ones with the wired mothers. These types of experiments show how we kind of like can get stuck in one way of looking at things based upon our past. I got kind of lost my train of thought.
No, it's fine. I think for this episode, we definitely learned to look at things a little bit differently. So is there anything you want to plug? You know, your car club or maybe your Atlanta Bondo, any websites or anything like that that you want to make sure people go and visit that are related to you? No other company?
Well, I go and I follow the Sage websites and the Pramek websites, of course, and it's been a pleasure learning from you guys and your expertise. You know, the purpose of the American Bondo Association is to honor the veterans that protect our freedoms. And I think that's what I think about. And, you know, Bondo's completely not for profit and, you know, make a donation to a veterans, organization to say thanks. And the police officers that protect our freedoms so that we can live with those freedoms.
Since you don't have a website other than the American Bondo Association, I'm a big fan of Wishes for Warriors.
Okay.
So they're a great organization.
And mental health. And go out and learn about mental health treatment, not from Scientology websites, but, I mean, from like, you know, APA or American Psychological or American Psychiatric Association or American Psychoanalytic Association. Learn about that. Learn about those things. And have a flexible mind in learning about that. Because by far the vast majority of people with mental illness are safe but suffering. And to get over that stigma, we have a long way to go so we can help these folks compassionately. It's like helping our returning vets with PTSD.
Yeah.
They've donated for us, so it's like, you know, how can we help them and welcome them back? I mean, one of the most, probably the single most memorable experience for me and touching experience in my training and even really my whole practice of psychiatry, I co-led a group of PTSD Vietnam vets at the VA when I was doing my training. I probably said 12 to 15 words the whole 6 months and did a lot of listening And I can still see all the guys' faces when they would come into the room and so forth. And when I finished my rotation, they all stood up and saluted me and shook my hand. Didn't say anything, didn't say a word, just shook my hand and nodded. And it's like, I'm still so honored by that, you know, just to hear their stories. One time, I think I told you guys, that was by mistake, I knocked over a chair in the room, and I, for the fraction of a second, I thought I was going to die, you know, but they laughed, fortunately, thank God. But I mean, it was an honor. It's a very, I was extremely honored.
Well, we're honored to have you here and appreciate you coming by, and we will definitely do this. I want to do in the future, I was talking to Sarah Jameson about this, is in the future, you know, because I've got some other guests kind of lined up, is to almost do a PTSD roundtable of a couple of different guests talking about different things. You know, everybody focuses in a certain direction. So definitely want to have you back on for that. And then we'll have you back on. There's a couple of notes that I have that we didn't even get to.
Okay.
So we'll make sure that we did.
Yeah, absolutely.
All right, folks, we're going to take a quick music break, and I'll be back with my final thoughts on this Pramek Radio episode with Dr. Brad Johns. Had a little bit of hate mail this week from last week's episode. I took the mic back and I didn't realize I was going to actually get some people that didn't like me taking the mic back, I guess. One of the questions that came in was, Matt, I can't believe that you're trying to say that MMA and UFC are remotely related to traditional martial art and combatives. I'm not even really going to take the time to deal with it. The thing that you have to remember is that you'll never make everybody happy. And if you try to make everybody happy, you're not going to. If you look at what Facebook's done, where they've exercised their right that when you sign up for Facebook, you have the terms and it says you have to use your real name. And for whatever reason that's out there, I have my theories and I'm not going to go into. They have exercised that you have to use your real name. You can't make everybody happy. And Facebook isn't making everybody happy right now, but Facebook's doing what's best for them. And for me, when I look at all of this and the exposure that we get through, you know, Pramek.com and now with Onnit and Moderno.com and Breach Pain Clear and everybody else that we've worked with over the years, I've realized that you will never make everybody happy. If you try to make everybody happy, you're simply going to end up unhappy in the end. I learned that a long time ago when I was teaching down in Florida. I was teaching down in Florida and I was staying with a student that was down there, and he didn't like the fact that I didn't bring his wife flowers when I stayed at their house. This turned from he didn't like the fact that I didn't bring flowers, and I didn't find out that he was actually upset about it until a couple of years later when he started claiming that I had injured and damaged his hands to the point that he couldn't work. Now, we had a waiver that he had actually listed his hand injuries before we went into the class, but what it really came down to was that he cornered me during lunch and asked me where the proceeds of the seminar were going. At that time, I was working on the cases manual, and I told him, I said, you know, it goes into the manual, it goes into videos, it goes into these things, but at the end of the day, you invited me down here where the money goes. It's not really your business. He wanted a cut of it, and I offered him a cut. He didn't like the percentage on the cut. So this bizarre online forum fight started. Now, this is like a long time ago. This is more than 10 years ago. And this bizarre online thing started where he was posting all over the place. And I finally posted up the waiver he had signed, and he ended up contacting me. Or no, I contacted him, actually. I said, what's the deal? It ended up the fact that I had stayed at his house twice, and, you know, I'm a Southerner, very respectful, make my bed up or lay it on the couch, make the sheets up in the morning. But he was upset that I didn't bring flowers to his wife. And that's when I realized back then that you won't make everybody happy. As you get out there and you put yourself out publicly,
But not even if you put yourself out publicly, but if you do, if you're a martial artist or firearms instructor or fitness instructor, there's going to be a lot of times that you got to sleep on people's couches. There's a lot of times where you show up and they said 20 people would be there and two show up. That's early on in your career before you figure out how to take care of your business. But you show up to all these different situations. You travel in your car. You drive all over the country. I mean, there was a period where I didn't even have a home. I was in the car with one of my dogs. We were eating out of the same peanut butter. It was Jif peanut butter, and that's not a plug. It was Jif peanut butter jar, and we were in between houses. And when you dedicate yourself to something that you truly love and the things that you want to do, you can sometimes end up in situations where people feel like they can take advantage of you because they see how much you love it. They know you're going to respond. Now, the great Joan Rivers recently passed away. But on one of her last On the Couch, I think that's what she called it, was On the Couch with Joan, she had Bianca Del Rio. And they were talking about don't read the comments, don't pay attention to the haters. I think early on in your career, whenever you're teaching something or maybe you've written a book, you've put it out there, you're going to have a lot of haters, and you believe in what you're doing so strongly that you'll do anything to defend it. You'll get on every forum and argue with people. Now, that was back in the day. It's not as much prevalent as it is now, but you'll go anywhere. You'll get on YouTube, you'll answer every single question. You'll get on Facebook, you'll answer every single hater. You get on Instagram, and if they don't like your stuff, you're going to answer every bit of it. And then one day you kind of wake up and you say, you know, yesterday I was really active, but I wasn't productive. I answered all these haters. I looked at my sales. I didn't see any of their names and their email addresses in my sales, but I spent my day answering them. And I actually ended up ignoring like some of the people that had, you know, contacted me or emailed me or posted up positive things that you say thanks to the person that posted up something positive. You say thank you to the person that posted up a review, but you spent a paragraph or two paragraphs responding to the hater. In reality, you're never going to make everybody happy. Everybody is out there for themselves in a lot of different situations until they get to know you and they feel comfortable with you. And so you end up having to defend yourself so many different times. And I've seen people go so crazy as they create false names on, you know, false accounts on forums and YouTube and Instagram. And they'll actually argue back and forth with themselves, and they'll argue back and forth with trolls. They do all these strange things, but they end up very active, but they're not productive. So as I read the email that had come in where the person was questioning what I had said last week on Pramek Radio on the podcast, I say it like it's third party. When I read the comment that had come in last week replying to the things I had talked about, I really had to take a second and say, am I going to take this time to reply to this person, write a couple of paragraphs, or am I going to let the things that I have put out there and the words that I have carefully chosen and the blog post that we just put up over at Pramek.com related to some of what we talked about last week with combatives, traditional martial art, and mixed martial art. Am I going to let those things stand on their own? Am I going to reply back to the person and say, look, I'm not going to engage you any further in this. My thoughts are out there. You have your thoughts. Let's see if we can move beyond. Or am I going to take that time, that 10, 15 minutes to reply? Because if you end up taking 10 to 15 minutes to reply to 5 to 10 people that might not like the exposure you're getting, next thing you know, you've wasted a couple hours. And that's hours that you could have been doing something for yourself. That's hours that you could have been working on your website, working on your product, working on your students, trying to push things ahead and find new partners. So I encourage you to recognize that you're never going to make everybody happy. And sometimes you won't make the people closest to you happy. But if you stay on mission, if you look at being productive rather than active, and you really try to push home the things that you want to accomplish, you're going to go a lot further. You know, every year, and I've done it for the past 5 years, people look at me weird because all of a sudden I disappear off the map. They're like, Matt, where'd you go? Every year at New Year's, right after New Year's, after my hangover subsides, and as the great Hank Williams Jr. said, they hurt more than they used to. As my hangover subsides, I go down to the local Pop Copy. That's a little joke there. I go down to the local, you know, Office Depot or Staples, and I pick up a very large flip chart, and I bring that flip chart in, and I plan out my year. I use a process at my day job. They've been great in that they've invested in me to the point where I've been able to see how things get planned over time. And I applied that to my own personal life and my own personal business. I use that time to really figure out the year ahead. You know, so many people look at the year ahead and they get bogged down in the minutiae because they never had the larger goals of the things that they actually wanted to accomplish. I learned this from John Cornetta, who will be coming on pretty soon, mentor of mine. He used to be my boss. I used to be his director of corporate security for a medium-sized company that he owned. I learned from him that if you get tied down in the minutiae and you don't have your overarching goals, the minutiae and solving the minutiae, those become your goals. When I look at Pramek and I look back on since, you know, 2011, when we really became public and started putting things out there, that's when I really instituted the yearly planning and my goals. And I look back on those sheets 2 times a year. I look at it on my birthday and say, where am I at with the personal things that I'm doing, with the things that I really wanted to do this year? And then I look at it midway through the year and say, did I reach the goals that I wanted to reach that I set for myself in June? And then I can kind of readjust and throw things out or put some things in that I didn't see beforehand. And then I can move past and I can push forward going into about November. Then I'll pull it out once in November and I'll look at it again. But I get so detailed in this that at the end of it, I actually go through my calendar. I spend an entire day on, well, at that time I had an Android. Don't get mad, folks. I had an Android. Now I would put it on the iPad. But I take all the different goals that I have and I organize it down. I'm actually going to release a manual on this pretty soon to where I actually put it all into my calendar week to week to week so that I stay on task. And as the minutiae comes in, I can always refer back to that list. The things that I had put forward at the beginning of the year, the things that I saw, the things that I checked in on a couple of times during the year. And I can always be checking in on myself and say, am I going down a rabbit hole or a rat hole that I don't want to go down? When you start to do that, you start to back off that minutiae and you realize that that email that comes in from somebody that is critiquing for the sake of critiquing, maybe they didn't do a yearly planning. Maybe this is their minutiae. Maybe they're bored at work and they're just looking for something to do. You back off and you look at it and go, is this helping me attain the goals that I set at the beginning of the year? I never want to wake up at, you know, God willing, if Google has their way, I may never die. But I never want to wake up at, you know, 80 or 90 years old and look back and say, man, there was so much minutia. I didn't accomplish anything. When I look at the life that I've led so far at 36 years old, I see an incredible amount of accomplishment. But that incredible amount of accomplishment was all planning. I planned to do certain things in my life. I chose those goals that I had when I got to the age where I really felt comfortable setting goals for myself. And I pushed forward with them and I kept working at them. And then as I learned more, I was able to, you know, round the edges and to hone the skill and really focus on those things that were my goals. And I started to get less inclined to reply to the minutiae to the point where I started turning off the Drudge Report. You know, I canceled my cable years ago. I don't watch the news. I know what's going on out there because my friends tell me. But I started to even view that as minutia. This is really important to me. I didn't get involved in it because I looked at myself when I was 80, when I was 90. And I asked myself the question, me spending a lot of time today on those things, is it going to matter when I'm 80 or 90? It's like when you have an argument with a girlfriend. Like Jeff Bramstead says, you know, that, you know, the things that come out of your mouth, those are seeds. And those seeds take hold and they grow a plant. And guess who ends up having to chop down those vines and deal with the poison ivy and everything else? It's you, because you planted them. Am I planting the seeds? And is spending those times going to really affect me when I'm 80 or 90 years old? And if it doesn't, and it's not something I can knock out pretty quickly, then I tend to move on from it as fast as it came along and it had me make that decision to move on. So I encourage you to do some planning, even if you sit down today and you go, what do I want to accomplish for the rest of the year? You know, it's September. We only got, what, 3-4 months left in the year? God, it's about to be Halloween and Thanksgiving and Christmas. What am I going to tell people at Thanksgiving, around the Thanksgiving table, that I've done this year? What am I going to tell people at Christmas? Am I going to have that side business and do those things to get a little bit more money so I can afford a little bit better Christmas presents? Or am I going to reply to a forum topic? Am I going to show up looking good like Ric Flair? Woo! Looking like $1 million, coming in the alligator shoes, looking like I want to look, feeling like I want to look. You know, am I going to come in? Am I going to be thinner? Am I going to be stronger? Am I going to be mentally more focused? Am I going to do those things? Or am I going to take the time that I could be working on those and researching those and answer the email from the person that knows how I feel and isn't going to help me get beyond it? So, you know, usually I talk about, you know, we make fun of a video. Next week, I've already got the video queued up. It's going to make a lot of people mad, but I got the video queued up for next week. We talk about those types of things, but at the end of the day, I felt like this week, instead of talking about those things, I'd step back, view them as minutiae. There's something that I view when I'm on lunch. I take that hour in my home office. I take that hour when I'm on the road and, you know, I unplug from the world a little bit and look at some things on YouTube to laugh at. Those are the minutiae. And we should never be so tied up in the minutiae that we end up forgetting who we want to be and where we got to go to get there. Thanks again to Dr. Brad for stopping by. Next week, we got Eric Mellon on. We'll be talking a lot about Onnit and warrior mode. Until then, this is Matt Powell, and I'm signing off.